faculty member here, and I'm here this week. And sometime, I think it was last summer, I was here for a few weeks, and David Krakauer and I were talking about who, just, you know, interesting people that we should bring into the SFI orbit. And Dan Lieberman's name came up, as Dan is a colleague and friend of mine, and David had read at least one, maybe two of his books. Dan's written many books on human evolution. He's a human evolutionary biologist. He's written about the evolution of the human head, about evolution and health, running. His most recent book is called Exercised, about the strange phenomenon of exercise, which in evolutionary history was never really an issue. And he's currently thinking about a book about human diets, different unusual diets, sort of transcending from the academic world into the world of science for the public. But he's going to talk today about the active grandparent hypothesis. Dan, welcome to SFI.
Yes, thank you.
I can't get the pointer to advance my slides, so I apologize if I dash forward and back. Anyway, thank you so much, Dan, for the nice introduction and getting me out here. It's nice to be here, and you know, thanks to the Santa Fe Institute. Wonderful dinner last night. And I hope that we get a chance to have some more conversations. So today, what I want to talk about. Hold on, why is this not working? You know what? For some strange reason. Let's see. Now is it working? Okay, now it's working. Okay. So one of the things I like to do before I start a talk is thank all the people who helped, because often at the end, nobody's thinking about thank you. So there's a lot of folks who've my lab and colleagues and collaborators who've been really important for this talk. And there are too many to name, but I just want to make sure that, that we all know that science is collaborative. And the science that I do is extremely collaborative. But what I study is really how and why the human body is the way it is. I'm an evolutionary biologist, as Dan said. For my day job, I'm really experimental biomechanist and do experimental physiology. So I combine sort of comparative anatomy and physiology. So I got into this field because I love fossils and bones and stuff like that. I was digging up stuff in Kenya when I was a grad student and all that. I do field work because I believe, as we'll talk about later on, that you can't really understand human bodies by just studying people in Cambridge, Massachusetts or Santa Fe. And of course, we also do work in the lab. We do experimental biomechanics and physiology. And here's somebody whose head we took off and put on a treadmill. But my major interest has become really over the last 15 years or so, the evolution of human physical activity. And I'm probably best known for my work on walking and running, but we've also studied throwing and sitting and chewing and digging and breathing and all kinds of other physical activities. And we're always looking for other interesting physical activities to study. And you know, normally most of the talks I give are kind of, you know, into the weeds kind of, you know, lectures on locomotor biomechanics, but given the audience today, I thought I'd have fun and do one of those 30,000 foot kind of lecture talks about a topic that has interested me for a while. It's a chapter in my book, and this is a shameless plug for the book, Exercise, which Dan mentioned. There's actually a chapter on this in the book, but we also just published a paper in PNAS, which has a lot of the details, so you can look that up if you want. And if you do what I do, or what Gretchen Reynolds, who's here, does, you know, you cannot help but be aware of what we call the exercise paradox, which is that we evolved to be physically active. Everybody in the world knows that exercise is good for you. You don't need to tell anybody that, right? But the problem is that most of us avoid physical activity. In the United States, based on sort of CDC data, only about 20% of Americans get the U.S. the recommended minimum of physical activity, right? That the WHO and the American Heart Association, every major organization in the world recommends, which is 150 minutes a week of moderate to vigorous physical activity. So that means you get your heart rate above 55% of its maximum. That's like a brisk walk or more. And the other 80% of people avoid it, right? And they actually only about half of Americans ever exercise at all. And I think that people are exercised, which means that they're ambivalent, they're confused, they're anxious, they feel shamed, and they feel bullied. And so my goal is to try to help us understand this perspective and why it's important using two guiding perspectives. So one is, of course, the old, cliche from Dobzhansky that nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. Actually, you could argue that nothing makes sense except in the light of evolution, but I would include physical activity as part of that. But also exercise and physical activity is a cultural construct, and we need to think about it also from an anthropological perspective. So nothing about the behavior of physical activity makes sense except in the light of anthropology. So today what I want to do is first briefly talk about the evolution of physical activity and inactivity, because that's important. Then I want to talk about exercise got weird. And then the kind of major portion of this talk is to talk about why physical activity is increasingly important as we age. And then finally, I just kind of throw out some kind of maybe controversial ideas about cancer as a way to kind of get a discussion going. So as a starting point, I think it's very important to understand that we evolved from apes, of course, and apes are actually relatively inactive creatures. They're basically couch potatoes. So one way of thinking about that, a very simple way of doing that, is what's called the physical activity level. So that's your total energy expended in a given day divided by your basal metabolic rate. So the energy you spend, just basically doing nothing, right? And most animals have PALs, physical activity levels, between about 2 and 3. There's a lot of variation. But apes are incredibly low on that scale. They have a physical activity level of about 1.5. And if you've ever had the chance to spend time with apes in the wild, you'll know that they basically just sit around and eat, and they really do very little. Occasionally there's short bursts of excitement and all that, and they copulate or run around trees, but really they're mostly just sitting around eating. A big shift occurred around 7 million years ago when the human and ape lineage split, the chimpanzee split. And we know, and I worked on this skull here, Sahelanthropus. But the very, very first hominids were bipeds. They're basically apes who walked on two legs. We have more data from this species here called Ardipithecus. And the big advantage, we think, of being a biped is it's much more efficient than the quadrupedal knuckle walking that apes do. So a chimpanzee, when walking, spends about twice as much energy per kilo, per unit distance, as a human being walking bipedal. And that's because they have an interesting sort of compromised anatomy that's good for climbing trees as well as walking quadrupedally, but that lowers their efficiency. We've put oxygen masks on chimpanzees and done force plated locomotor studies to figure out why that's the case. I'd be happy to talk about that later on. So that's the good thing about being bipedal, where it makes us more efficient, at least initially. But the costs are that, of course, once you're a biped, you're much less stable, right? You're more awkward. We only have two legs to support you instead of four. And also with only two legs, you become slow by definition, right? You can produce power with half the number of limbs of a quadruped. And so humans are about half as fast per unit body mass as quadrupeds of similar size, right? So we became slow, which meant that we became easy pickings for saber-toothed tigers and other creatures out there back a few million years ago. So if you were living a few million years ago and you wanted to have dinner and you wanted to get a really easy prey, you'd go for a hominid. Fortunately, our ancestors survived. Those early hominids survived. And then the next really big shift started occurring with the origins of the ice age, right? So starting around 2.8 million years ago, this is a curve that some of you know very well, the famous Zaikos curve. And you can see starting around 2.8 million years ago, this is the temperature of the oceans, that there was a major cooling event. And we know that in Africa, that led to an expansion of grassland habitats. And we see in the archaeological record the origins of the hunting and gathering system of life, right? This is with the genus Homo. And hunting and gathering is really kind of an interesting combination of behavior. We have obviously hunting or scavenging. So there's meat as becomes an important component of the diet. We have evidence for meat eating going back at least 3.3 million years ago, but it picks up around 2.6 million years ago, and you have increase in use of stone tools and things like that. Gathering is not just like plucking berries off a tree, but also digging and getting high quality resources that yield high returns. You can't make the system work without tool making and food processing, which certainly occurs back then. And then finally, you need cooperation, you need intense levels of cooperation, such as division of labor and so on, right? So, and all together, these create the hunting and gathering system, which was very efficient and effective. But it also led to a significant increase in physical activity levels. So if you look at hunter-gatherer populations, and there's data from quite a few populations now, their PALs average about 2. right? Which is a significant increase over chimpanzees. Another way of looking at that is travel distance per day, right? So chimps will walk about 2 to 4 kilometers a day on average. They don't really go very far. Whereas an average female hunter-gatherer, this is an average from across quite a few different populations, walks about 9 kilometers a day. Average male hunter-gatherer walks about 15 kilometers a day. So to put that into perspective, your average hunter-gatherer walks from LA to Washington, DC every year, right? That's just normal for human beings for the last few million years. And this is kind of a fun way of thinking about it. Even sedentary Westerners, right? Who, if you actually look at how many calories they spend per day on active energy expenditure, it's the total amount of energy. That's like going to the bathroom and you know, knitting and whatever, anything that involves activity, and you standardize by fat-free body mass. Even sedentary humans spend more energy per day on physical activity than wild chimpanzees, which is pretty impressive. And of course, hunter-gatherers spend way more energy than, I'm sorry, I shouldn't be making fun of Bernie Sanders, but it's just a good, yeah. It's become a meme.
Sorry.
Yes.
Calories, you're right, is kilocalories.
I'm sorry?
Those calories are kilocalories?
Yes, those are kilocalories.
Okay, fine.
With capital C.
Okay.
Right. That's how most of us do kilocalories here.
Does fat-free body mass tend to correlate with the basal metabolic rate?
No, generally not. Very little. So fat-free mass does. Yes, exactly. Exactly. So because fat is mostly inert, metabolic inert. Not as inert as some people think it is, but it's pretty inert. So that's why we standardize by fat-free body mass. Which is, yeah, mostly muscle, but of course other things too.
Okay, so this is an estimate of the PAL that you're talking about.
Well, no, this is just a way of, because, you know, animals of different size will spend different amounts of energy. So this is just standardizing by size. It's just a size standardization. What I really should have done is given you the scaling relationship. I realize it's in Santa Fe, but these are all animals of the same size. So it's not that big a deal. I mean, chimps and humans weigh basically the same thing. So it's not, yeah. It's actually not very good data. But one of the things that, so we think about hunter-gatherers being way more active than humans today, but of course we need to be a little bit careful about it. There's all kinds of myths out there about hunter-gatherers, and one of them is that they're these super active, constantly hardworking people who never sit, they, you know, get the proper amount of sleep every night, and they're incredibly strong. And I just want to briefly pop some of those myths here. So it turns out that the Hadza sit about as much as Americans do. They sit about, the Hadza are a hunter-gatherer population in Tanzania. That I've had the privilege of visiting a few times. And so they sit about as much as we do. I think I'm standing on that slide, sorry about that. But they do sit a little bit differently in that they, like all of you are sitting in chairs with backrests, most of you are actually leaning back, you know, it's very comfortable, et cetera. But they don't have chairs with backrests. They usually sit on the ground. And also Americans, the average sitting bout for an American is about 40 minutes at a time. Whereas the populations that don't have chairs tend to get up constantly, tend the fire or take care of kids, et cetera. So they have shorter sitting bouts, which have important and interesting metabolic effects. We hear that you have to sleep 8 hours a night. That's just nonsense. And it turns out that people who don't have electricity and internet, smartphones or anything like that, none of them get 8 hours a night. And I know that from personal experience of living in some of these camps. People are up all the time. It turns out that various a study of sleeping duration for various populations that have no access to any kind of electricity, they sleep between 5.7 and 7.1 hours a night. They also tend to actually rarely nap as well. And just in case you're interested, these are data on the all these U-shaped curves for various hazard ratios of horrible outcomes, and they almost always bottom out at about 7 hours of sleep. So 8 hours is just kind of made up crap. They're strong, but they're not super strong. Yes, go ahead.
Oh, for that last plot, is it known which way the causality goes in terms of,
no,
like, is
of
sleeping
not.
Less or more yeah. indicative of other symptoms that give you heart disease?
Well, okay, yeah. Sure, of course. Right. This slide doesn't go through all the covariates, but of course there are plenty of studies that have corrected for that, et cetera. But of course, I mean, obviously if you're really sick, you're gonna sleep more, right? So absolutely. But this is not a controversial slide, actually. If you wanna look at strength, for example, this is just a one particular population in the Amazon, but they're reasonably strong and they manage to maintain their strength as they age, but they're not super strong, kind of jacked kind of individuals, which actually makes sense because muscle is really expensive and having extra muscle is really costly. You only want as much as you can afford, and you don't want any more than it's necessary. And finally, in terms of the amount of physical activity they get, if you measure moderate to vigorous physical activity, so again, getting your brisk walk or higher, they average about 2.25 hours a day. And which is not an insane amount. It's about 6 to 10 times more than your average American, but it's not a crazy amount of physical activity. So if you're walking, they're carrying, they're digging, they're climbing, but they're also sitting a lot too. And if you look at these populations, or spend time with these populations, you realize that they're physically active for two reasons and two reasons only, right? They're physically active when it's necessary, right? When to get food or to avoid being somebody else's food, right? Or when it's somehow otherwise rewarding, like dancing, for example, for mate attraction and things like that. Other than that, they take it easy, right? And it makes sense to take it easy because energy in these populations is limited, right? Just like time is a limited resource for all of us now. So the time you're spending listening to me, perhaps it's time wasted that you could have spent working on a paper, et cetera. You'll never get these minutes back, right? And in populations like this, calories are also a limited resource. So anytime you spend calories on one thing, you're not spending it on something else. There's inevitable trade-offs in these populations. And in energy allocation theory, I'm sure some of you work on this yourselves because you're interested in life history, but you can spend it on only five things. You can spend energy on growth, maintenance, storage, which of course is a two-way arrow, reproduction and physical activity. And obviously the only thing that natural selection cares about is reproduction ultimately, right? So anytime you can spend less energy on physical activity, plow it into reproduction, you win, right, from a natural selection perspective. And so it makes sense not to spend energy on unnecessary physical activity unless it has some kind of benefit, right? And that makes sense, especially when energy is limited. So how did exercise get so weird? So by weird, I mean, some of you may know Joe Henrich's work, my colleague, Western, industrialized, educated, rich, and democratic, which is about, 10% of the world or so. And so actually Mike Gervin and I did a study where we got some students to help us, but we looked at every single paper that was published in the year 2018 in the world's top three medical journals, JAMA, The Lancet, and New England Journal of Medicine. And we looked at the total, who was being studied in medical journals. 80% of the data comes from weird populations. So we have a very, very biased sense of what it's like to be a normal human being in terms of how our bodies function, right? We're basically sampling, getting 80% of our data from about 9% of the world, right? And so we have as I said before, we have a very limited and biased view of what's normal, right? And so we're missing that. So the question then really is, how did exercise get so weird, right? And the answer is, it goes back, of course, to the agricultural revolution. So starting around 600 generations ago, people started, instead of hunting and gathering, they started farming. And if you look at the physical activity level of farmers, and remember that's for hunter-gatherers, it's around 2. Farmers have to work just a little bit harder on average than hunter-gatherers, right? And this is actually from that area where I work in Kenya. I mean, I can tell you, these folks work really hard trying to. Here's a plow, a handheld plow. I once tried this. It was one of the hardest. I mean, you need incredible strength and endurance to do this kind of stuff. They're carrying everything. There's no running water. There's no electricity. Subsistence farmers work really, really hard, right? And when they're not working, they sit under a tree, right? Because that makes sense. They're also calorie limited, right? But all of that really shifted in recent times, in the last few generations, as we've invented machines to do human labor, right? So now in high income countries, physical activity levels have dropped by about at least 25%, which is, we're talking 300, 400 calories a day of energy, less energy spent on being physically active. That's an enormous biological shift. That many calories. And as a result, we've had to invent this weird thing called exercise, which is discretionary, voluntary physical activity for the sake of health and fitness, right? Nobody no hunter-gatherers, no subsistence farmers do like what Gretchen and I did this morning, was go for a completely useless 3.5 mile run for no purpose at all other than it was good for us, right? Nobody does that when you're energy limited and you have to work really hard. And it's funny, this seems like such an obvious thing, but I had spent years and years working on this sort of stuff. And for me, I did actually have kind of a eureka aha moment. It was when I was in 2012, and I was collecting data in the Sierra Tarahumara. In fact, this picture of me studying somebody's foot. I was studying running biomechanics. It was way up in a tiny little farm, way up at the top of this mesa here. And I met this guy who was an elderly Tarahumara, sort of well known to be a runner. And I was a good anthropologist. I had my list of questions. I was asking everybody about running. And this guy's known to be a runner. And And of course, it turns out most of the Tarmar don't run these long distances as they're claimed to do, et cetera. But that's neither here nor there. But this guy was a runner, and I was asking about how he trained. And I had asked this question before, and the translator I was working with was struggling to get answers from my little question about training. And she's explaining that this gringo here, you know, runs, you know, 5 miles every morning or whatever, you know, to kind of for running. And he said to the translator, why would I run if I didn't have to? And here's a guy who runs like 70 mile races occasionally. And of course it was like, you know, it's not that big an insight, but I suddenly just struck me, right? Of course, that people like me are weird. And in an environment like this, we have to work really hard all the time. That's your training, right? That's how they get ready to run, you know, long races, but they don't, nobody there goes for a 5 mile run. And to me, the apotheosis of just how weird exercise is the treadmill, right? It's loathsome, horrible device. It's expensive. It's noisy. It can spit you off, give you treadmill burns, et cetera. You spend a lot of money on a machine that makes you work really hard and you get absolutely nowhere, nothing out of it. Imagine explaining to your great-great-grandparents that you actually spent money on a treadmill. I think it's pretty, pretty weird, right? And if you realize that think a treadmill is a form of torture, it's true, actually. The treadmill was, the modern sort of version of the treadmill was invented in the Victorian era in prisons to prevent prisoners from actually having a good time in prison. So people like Oscar Wilde were actually forced to trudge on these treadmills to just to make their lives miserable. So there's a deep history of people not liking treadmills. but nonetheless, no matter how you cut the cookie, right? Now how you think about it, exercise or physical activity is unquestionably healthy. And so this is a study that I'm sure Gretchen knows extremely well. It's one of many very large studies. This is one on well more than 500,000 people. These are from Weird Science, of course, where you look at exercise dose here. Again, this is minutes of moderate to vigorous physical activity per week. The histogram is the percentage of people who actually do various doses of physical activity. And the bar is their percentage of, is the all-cause mortality rate, which is age standardized. And you can see that even getting an hour a week, right, lowers your all-cause mortality rate by about 20%. At 150 minutes a week lowers it by about 30%. And of course, eventually it tails off and there's no real shift. And by the way, the slight increase at the end is not statistically significant. So anyway, it tells you can exercise too much. There's actually no empirical evidence for the case. So you don't really need to actually all that much physical activity to actually get a really amazing benefit.
That must be age standardized.
Yes, that's age standardized. That's an age standardized mortality rate, of course, obviously. But I'm going to get to age in just a second. I could spend the next hour showing you study after study after study that exercise is helping you all hate me, right? So a much more interesting question is, why is that the case? And in particular, we often think about exercise being important for children, but I've gotten very interested in exercise and aging and why it is that exercise is increasingly healthy as we age. And for me, really, the starting point for this is a very famous study. It was actually done at my home institution, Harvard, by a very influential sort of giant in the field, Ralph Paffenbarger. Paffenbarger, who was studying the effects of exercise, realized that places like Harvard are fantastic for this kind of study, because if any of you are alums of a university like Harvard, which is constantly asking you for money, right, they never let alums go, right? You know, you could be on a desert island and they'll still find you and ask you for a donation, right? And so he convinced the Harvard alumni office to let him collect data on several classes and follow them over 20-something years. And so he collected data on their physical activity levels and their habits like smoking and their all kinds of stuff like that. And this is kind of like the summary slide from, there's of course a lot of published, but here again on the x-axis is physical activity in terms of calories per week. So 2000 calories a week is basically, I don't know, it's like 4 or 5 mile runs a week, right? So it's not a crazy amount of physical activity, but it's, you know, it's not trivial, right? And here people basically got very little, they just climbed stairs occasionally. And he broke them down into age groups. So in the 25 to 49 age group, right? And this is standardized to mortality rate of one, the individuals who got 2000 calories a week of physical activity had 21% lower mortality rates. In their 50s, they had 36% lower mortality rates. And in their 70s and 80s, they had 50% lower mortality rates. And again, these have been, this is not the first study. This is the first study to show this, but this has been replicated over and over again. And correcting, if you're going to ask the question, correcting for the bias that occurs for people who are already sick. So you can correct for that, right? There's no question as you get older that the benefits of physical activity turn out to be more substantial from just an empirical statistical perspective. And that raises kind of an interesting question that I've been sort of thinking about. This is kind of my pandemic thing to think about, right? And the question is why? And I think the answer for this comes from our unique life history. So most animals, grow up fast and die young. Right? And monkeys are long-lived compared to most animals, but a typical monkey might last about 20 years or so, and it's an adult by the time it's about 6 years old. Chimpanzees have slowed that life history down considerably. So they reach maturity around the age of 12, and very, very few chimpanzees in the wild live past the age of 30 or 40. But in zoos and occasionally in the wild, they can live up to their 40s and 50s. But that's it. But humans, of course, we've slowed everything down. We have this long period of childhood and infancy. We have this long juvenile period. So in non-Western societies where there's not a huge amount of energy, most people don't become reproductively mature until they're about 18 or so. And then the average hunter-gatherer actually lives between about 68 and 78 years of age, right? And they go through a long post-reproductive period, usually about an average of about 20 years, right? So we have this long post-reproductive period, which is essentially unique. The only other animal I know that has that is our orcas, the killer whales. We don't really know that much about orcas, but we do know something about humans. And this is kind of a puzzle because that post-reproductive period is what is well known to be, and what Sir Peter Medawar called the selective shadow, right? Which is that once you stop reproducing, natural selection shouldn't care about you, right? Because you're useless, right? There's no reason for you to exist from a selective perspective. I'm sorry to be so blunt, but that's the way. So as we age, we get older, but as we age, we also begin to senesce, and as reproductive your reproductive period ends, senescence is no longer, there's less selection to fight senescence. And so one of the questions, of course, is how delayed is the selective shadow in humans? As I said before, average hunter-gatherers live to be about 68 to 78, but chimpanzees in the wild live on average about 33 years, and their maximum lifespan, and depending on which population and whether it's wild or whatever, is between 44 to 66. 66 is like one right up there in this. Clearly an old chimpanzee, right? So humans have really extended that selective shadow and altered that selective shadow. And the most common hypothesis or set of hypotheses for them, there's a bunch of them. Some of you may have heard of the grandmother hypothesis, but there's also the embodied capital hypothesis, but they're all basically variants of the same thing, which is that in human beings, we have intergenerational transfers of information and energy and whatnot from grandparents to children and their grandchildren. And that provides a selective benefit for living longer, right? And so that's been the kind of classic story, right? We've evolved to become grandparents because it benefits our children and our grandchildren, and thereby benefits our reproductive success. But it's been kind of actually measuring that turns out to be a challenge. If you actually look at the data, so the heritability, for example, of lifespan prior to the age of 80 is pretty small actually, and that most of the variants in lifespan come from environmental factors such as your behavior, like whether you smoke and how physically active you are, and your social circumstances like stress and access to healthcare. By the way, it's only about 10% of the variance in your healthcare outcome, which is a kind of scary statistic, given how we spend about 20% of our GDP on this. But anyway, and really, if you think about it, we focus so much on lifespan, but what really matters is health span. So health span is how long you live without major chronic disease, right? Without major and we have and data from hunter-gatherers and we have some archaeological data suggests that until recently hunter-gatherers lived between up to their 60s or 70s, etc. And that there's very little evidence for the kind of chronic morbidity that we have in populations today. Whereas in America today, the average health span of an American is 63, average lifespan of an American is 79. So we spend about 16 years. On average, before we die, in a state of chronic morbidity from diabetes or heart disease, etc. You all know the problem. And of course, and we often think this is a great thing because we compare ourselves not to hunter gatherers, we compare ourselves to farmers, right? So if you compare yourself to a farmer from a few hundred generations ago, like a French farmer at the time of the revolution, you know, they, you know, people died young, and but also they also had very short periods of morbidity. So we think it's like a big triumph, right? Today we get to live longer, because we have modern medicine and technology, and of course the side effect is that we also get to we have the benefit of having diabetes and heart disease, etc. But that's just not true. You can live a long a health span without that. And furthermore, and the reason we're able to live so long today with all those chronic diseases is because of medical care. In fact, there the interesting study I would love to do, but I don't think the population exists, but if any of you can think of it, would be to look at a population of individuals who are not physically active, but also to have no access to healthcare, right? And to test what the effect of healthcare on lifespan versus health span. But anyway, so this led to what we call the active grandparent hypothesis, which is that humans evolved extended health spans. And remember, prior to modern medicine, health span equals lifespan, basically. Not just to be physically active, in other words, to hunt and gather, but also because of the physical activity, right? In other words, that healthy longevity is both not only a cause, but also an effect of physical activity, right? And so there are four kind of hypotheses to kind of test this, right? The first is that humans evolved to be more physically active than our ape ancestors, which I've already showed you. The second is that we evolved to remain physically active as we age and to help provide energy transfers to younger generations. Third, that there was selection for physical activity to promote health span, hence lifespan. And finally, that, and this is a kind of the more controversial one, or the least hardest to test, is that physical activity has more of an effect on human versus non-human lifespan. So the first, let's go through these hypotheses. The first one's easy because I already showed it to you, right? So so that humans evolved to be more physically active than our ancestors. That's a no-brainer, right? All that great apes are have very low physical activity levels. Hunter-gatherers have at least 25% higher physical activity levels. That's clearly true. That's not a controversial statement. So the second is that humans evolve to remain physically active as we age. And all the data that we have from non-Western populations, from subsistence farmers, from hunter-gatherers, indicates that's very much the case. So here's data from one population. These are the Hadza. These are data collected by my former grad student, Herbert Ponzer, and others. And chimpanzees, but you can see that chimpanzees, as they age, don't walk very, this is walk, how much they walk per day against age. Chimpanzees don't walk very much. Average Westerners walk very little at all. Of course, as we get older, we tend to walk less. The Hadza walk way more. This is an average of males and females together. And as they age, they do walk less, but they still walk, you know, several times more at equivalent age as they age than Westerners. Another way of looking at it is, again, at moderate to vigorous physical activity per day. Again, age, these are US males and females, and it's the Hadza, males and females. And as you can see, as hunter-gatherers age, they do spend less energy on moderate to vigorous physical activity, but they're still, you know, 6 to 10 times more active than Westerners of the same age. Here's another way of showing this. This is data from Kristen Hawk. Some of you may know Kristen Hawk at Utah, but she studied how many hours per day mothers spend females spend digging underground storage orchids, tubers, basically. So, you know, kids basically do very little. Mothers spend about 2 to 5 hours a day. Grandmothers, people who are post-reproductive, spend about 4 to 8 hours a day digging up foods to supply to their offspring. And I could go on and show you more and more slides, but it, again, hit me. But the reason this is important, this is from a super famous study by Hilly Kaplan et al., is that this is what underlies the hunter-gatherer strategy, right? So in yellow here, so you have age on the x-axis here, and calories, killed calories today per day on the y-axis. And this is what chimpanzees produce and consume, because chimpanzees don't share food, so what they use is what they get. And these are females on the left and males on the right. And here are hunter-gatherers, what they consume in the dashed line and what they produce in the solid line. As you can see, that female hunter-gatherers are actually in a deficit up until they become grandparents, right? So they're consuming more than they produce, but when they become grandmothers, they start producing a surplus, which of course they provide to their children and their grandchildren. And of course, males provide an important surplus, which again, they provide to their families. This is the essence of sharing, right, and of cooperation and division of labor. So I think we can tick off hypothesis two: hunter-gatherers remain physically active as they age. So hypothesis three is that there's been selection in humans for physical activity to help promote health span it has also a lifespan. And I'd like to go into a little bit of this. Again, I'm gonna say at a kind of higher-ish theoretical level, but I think there are two key mechanisms here. One is very well understood, and the other is kind of hasn't been thought about so much. And these involve energetic trade-offs, which you've talked about before, but also investment in repair and maintenance, which again is energetically costly and therefore is traded off. So I'd like to again go back to our energy allocation model, energy in, babies out, but also physical activity, storage, maintenance, and growth being the other key expenditures. And there are three kinds of trade-offs that are going on that are stimulated by physical activity, which has resulted in selection for mechanisms that promote healthy aging. So the first trade-off is that, and this is the one that I think most people know already, is that physical activity diverts energy from reproduction. You may think that's kind of weird, right? But actually, what it does is actually diverts excess energy from reproduction. So here's a very famous study that was done actually in my department by Peter Ellison, where he looked at sedentary Bostonians and compared them to matched healthy controls, matched healthy women who are running on average 20 kilometers a week around the Charles River, right? So that's an average of 180 calories a day. Physical activity is not a huge exercise burden, right? And he measured estrogen and progesterone levels across the cycle. I'm just gonna show you the progesterone data here. You can see that during the luteal phase of the cycle, their progesterone levels were something like 50% lower. Now, one way to think about this is, oh my gosh, exercise makes you less fertile, right? Or fecund, I guess I should say, right? But that's not true. These women had no problem reproducing. Another way of thinking about it is that when you're physically inactive, because this is the normal, right? This is normal. When you're physically active, your body realizes, oh my gosh, I've got some extra energy. Let's plow it into reproduction. So you have abnormally high levels of progesterone and estrogen, right? And so this is the abnormal mismatch condition that almost no female ever experienced for millions and millions of years, right? And of course, that has important effects in terms of, for example, reproductive cancers. We'll talk about cancer at the end, but this is one of many, many studies. I'll show you some meta-analyses later on, but this is how many hours a week this is a metabolic equivalence. Basically, if you have a 30 METs hours per week, that's like an hour of walking a day, right? Against the odds ratio of getting estrogen or progesterone sensitive breast cancer. And you can see that an hour a day of walking lowers your risk, a female's lifetime risk, by about 55%. There are many, many studies. I'll show you some more data on this. And you can see it's a dose response effect. So, and that's because these are mitotic hormones that increase the probability of breast cancer. Same is true of testosterone and prostate cancer, et cetera. And I see Gretchen's nodding her head because she's written about this in countless articles in the New York Times. But these are not controversial data. Right? So that's one trade-off. A second trade-off, which is also not so abstruse, is that physical inactivity diverts surplus energy to storage. Just like you have extra energy, you can plow into reproduction. The other way to, of course, improve your reproductive success is to store energy so that you can use it for when times are bad, and that means storing fat. And so there's a big debate going on now about how much exercise helps you lose weight, but what's not being debated is how much exercise helps prevent weight gain. That's a very solid figure. And this is a famous study that was done by Bente Peterson, who I've been collaborating with, that she got a bunch of Danish young men who walk on average 10,000 steps a day. She basically made them sit on a couch for 2 weeks, and she scanned them before and after. And you can see that at just 2 weeks of that kind of reduction led to a 7% increase. You can see the visceral fat here. That's the belly fat that's highly inflammatory. That's the stuff you should be worried about. A 7% increase in visceral fat, and they basically became pre-diabetic. They had high levels of plasma triglycerides. They're insulin levels shot up. I mean, this is a very metabolically unhealthy state. And of course, it's caused by an adaptation to divert energy towards storage when you have excess energy, right? And that excess energy, of course, here was made possible by the fact that they were no longer spending energy on physical activity. Yes.
But is that caused by this actually kind of extreme perturbation of no exercise for 2 weeks?
Well, I mean, that is the intervention. But there are plenty of people who take only 1,500 steps a day, and we know what happens. They're gaining weight, yes. So, it's the energy balance difference that's causing the weight gain.
Sure. I'm just wondering if those dramatic results are a consequence of that rather abrupt perturbation for that.
Well, you could repeat the experiment and find that the perturbation is causing the weight gain. That's the only, because their diet was health constant. Everything was health constant for these individuals. There's lots and lots of studies with showing that absence of physical activity is related to weight gain.
And it happens in less than 2 weeks. I've written about those studies too. Yeah. So it happens in 4 days.
Yeah. Thank you. I mean, this is not controversial data. Again, this is just one of many studies. And the problem is that then you get this interaction because as fat cells swell, they become damaged and they attract white blood cells and they turn on an inflammatory response, which causes systemic chronic inflammation, which is related to a whole bunch of diseases. But the other thing that happens is that it turns on that muscle is a very active inflammatory organ. It turns out that the major producer of cytokines that regulate inflammation are actually not produced by white blood cells. It's actually produced by muscle and turned on by physical activity. We call them myokines, right? And the IL-6 turns out to be the major one. We just published a major paper in Nature Metabolism just a few weeks ago. But what happens is that so when you turn on muscle, you basically turn off inflammation. So people who are physically inactive are not only storing more fat, which causes inflammation, they're not turning on the major system that actually regulates inflammation in the first place. And if you get a double whammy, right? And so the combination gives you, increases your vulnerability to every disease we know, which is inflammatory related, which is most of the diseases that most of us are scared of, like Alzheimer's, atherosclerosis and diabetes and hypertension and some cancers, et cetera, right? They're all inflammatory related. And of course, a contributing factor is this interaction. Okay, so that's the second trade. The third trade-off is the one that I've become really interested in, and we're doing a lot of work in the lab now, which is that physical activity diverts energy towards mechanisms that promote repair and maintenance in the bodies. Maybe this is the most important of these mechanisms, or the one that's been least appreciated. So like when Gretchen and I went for a run this morning, we stressed our bodies, right? We may have caused little micro cracks in our bones, and our mitochondria spurted out all kinds of reactive oxygen species, and there was protein denaturation, and every system of the body you can think of is actually stressed by physical activity, thermoregulatory stress and metabolic stress and physical stress, et cetera. And these are all, of course, you know, well-known and well-documented, right? But for every single one of these forms of stress, there are well-known mechanisms the body has to repair and maintain, right? So you produce, for example, reactive oxygen species, but muscles especially produce a ton of antioxidants, right? Like glutathione or superoxide dismutase, which are really powerful antioxidants. Physical activity turns on bone repair mechanisms, and it turns on muscle repair mechanisms, and the list goes on. BDNF for the brain, for example. All of these, and many of these molecules, by the way, initially evolved for energy regulation and got co-opted for kinds of repair and maintenance mechanisms. That's another story. So, and the important thing is that these kinds of stresses are normal, right? Because until recently, everybody had to undergo daily stress, right? And that then turned on these mechanisms. And so there's been strong selection, I believe, for physical activity induced stress to stimulate repair and maintenance, right? And so gone through some of these. And I could, we could go into great detail. I'd be happy to talk to you about some of these particular mechanisms. So one example, I think I just mentioned it before, it's one of my favorites, is brain-derived neurotrophic growth factor. Some of you may be aware of this. Some people call it miracle growth for the brain, but what people often don't recognize is that BDNF evolved for energy regulation in muscle. It actually activates beta oxidation, so fat burning in muscle. So when you exercise, your muscles produce BDNF, which turn on AMPK, which cause fat oxidation, which releases energy. It was only later that BDNF, from evolutionary terms, BDNF was subsumed by the brain, and now it's involved in maintaining neurons and in promoting new neurons and regulating some neurotransmitters like glutamate and GABA and so it's very, very strongly associated with cognitive preventing cognitive decline, preventing Alzheimer's, and so on. So that's a good example. And we can sort of actually kind of estimate how much energy is being allocated for these trade-offs by through a very well-known, extremely well-studied phenomenon called EPOC, or excess post-exercise oxygen consumption, which is more colloquially known as afterburn, which is that if you look at your kind of resting energy expenditure rates, your metabolism right now, you're not really doing much, right? Most of you are all just sitting here thinking what an idiot I am, but apart from that, you're not really doing very much, right? So now, if we all, after this, you're inspired and we go for a run after this talk, you'll spend out some energy. And then afterwards, you're not gonna measure the energy in the running, but afterwards it'll take quite a few hours, depending on the intensity and the dose and the duration of the physical activity, for your energy expenditure to go back down to resting time. And it turns out that the vast majority of that energy is not, in terms of replacement of energy, the vast majority is turning on these repair and maintenance mechanisms, right? So, and we can calculate, and the paper gives all kinds of calculations, but we can kind of come up with here's just a very simple calculation, but we can, based on studies, again, done in the lab where you can measure these things very carefully, you can estimate, and again, the confidence interval is that if you take the 135 minutes a day, so the 2.25 hours that your average hunter-gatherer spends in moderate to vigorous physical activity, you can actually calculate that the average energy spent on EPOC after correcting for phosphagen replacement is between 42 and 98 calories a day. It's about 3 to 5% of your resting energy expenditure, which is between 5 to 14 marathons a year. So it's a substantial amount of energy, yes.
How much variation is there across individuals in the steepness of that? How much variation is there across individuals in the steepness of that curve you showed on the previous
slide? That's a good question. There is variation that's built into this confidence interval, but I'm not sure if there's been enough studies to understand the variance really well, because these are challenging studies to do, right? You can't just do them really easily. So there's the sample size is not huge, but these have been replicated. You know, this is EPOC is a very well studied phenomenon. Again, I know I keep sounding like a broken record, but yeah, there's variance, of course, like any biological. I'm just giving you the means and the confidence. And finally, and I think most, and this is the most hand-wavy part of the talk, is that as I would predict that because of our unusual life history, you can also make the case, but the hypothesis is not dependent on this, but I think it's an interesting additional hypothesis, is that physical activity has more of effect on human versus non-human lifespan. So for me, if I could like dream up any experiment in the world I'd like to do, I'd like to get some chimpanzees and like get them to exercise every day on a treadmill and see if I can increase their health span, enhance their lifespan. Mm-hmm. Obviously I can never do that for many reasons. It's unethical. You can't do experiments like that on chimpanzees, but also it's physiologically impossible because chimpanzees can't sweat like humans can, so they can't cool off very effectively. They don't have the metabolism to do it. They don't have the muscle physiology. They're mostly fast twitch muscle fibers, et cetera. So it'd actually be a challenge to do that in chimpanzees, but it'd be interesting to see what happens. But first, the experiment has been done on other animals. And of course, there's plenty of rodent studies. I'm just gonna show you two, one on rats and one on mice. Some of you may know, I can mention, some of you may know Ted Garland's mice, for example, who run long distances. They also die actually younger than the control mice. But when you actually exercise rats, you exercise mice, and I'm not just like talking about putting them on treadmills, which might be stressful, but just like normal running on a wheel that isn't stressful for them, it's actually stress relieving for them. The exercise mice actually tend not to, and rats actually don't live longer. So we don't see the same effect in rodents as we see in humans. So if anybody says, you know, exercise is good for rats too, it's just not true. There's no evidence for that. Here's another, this is kind of a more difficult analysis, but it was a study that was published in Nature Scientific Reports a few years ago where they looked at zoo versus wild animals, to try to look at maximum lifespan. So you can look at maximum longevity in zoos versus in the wild. And they tried to estimate rates of senescence by looking at the slope from age of sexual maturity up to maximum lifespan. And if you thought if physical activity was the thing that helps you do better, you'd think that the wild animals would do better, but actually zoo animals do way better, right? And of course there's confounding factors here. There's diet and veterinary treatment, et cetera. So, you know, it's not the best data and I recognize that. But again, just trying to find evidence for. But all in all, I think that the evidence is clear, right? We evolved to stay physically active as we age, and that physical activity through various kinds of energy allocation means not only turns off bad stuff, but turns on good stuff that helps us senesce effectively, right? And that's why study after study after study after study shows that physical activity is an extremely effective way of decreasing our vulnerability to a wide range of diseases, from heart disease to cancer, to Alzheimer's, et cetera, even respiratory tract infections like COVID. So there was a study that was published a little over a year ago and showing that using from Kaiser Permanente data, but individuals who got 150 minutes a week after correcting for every other covariant you can think of were 2.5 times less likely to die from COVID, 1.7 times less likely to be hospitalized from COVID. And we know why, because physical activity turns on natural killer cell production and cytotoxic T cell production. I mean, the mechanisms are actually fairly well understood. It's not a black box. But just to kind of finish on a cheery note, I thought maybe we could take one disease and kind of look a little bit at the data, and I'll pick the one that I'm most scared of is cancer, right? Which is the number two cause of death in the world. And heart disease kills about, most of us in this room are probably going to die from one of those diseases or the other. And so one of the questions is, how protective is physical activity? And the second question is, why? Now, I know I don't have to tell a room like this full of theoretical biologists and whatever that cancer is basically a byproduct of multicellular life. As soon as you have multicellular life, you have the opportunity for cells to start competing with each other and cheating and causing cancer. You find it in dinosaurs and mummies and all kinds of stuff like that. If you look in the historical and anthropological literature, it's hard to confirm, because of course you can't do biopsies from the 1800s or so on. But you know, every line of evidence points to cancer becoming significantly more prevalent in the modern world, right? So studies that have tried to diagnose cancer and hunter-gatherer populations find essentially almost no evidence for it. Historical evidence is also interesting. There was a famous doctor in Verona who actually tried to quantify how much cancer was occurring in the hospital in Verona, and he calculated it to be 1% of hospital deaths. By the way, he noticed that it's primarily nuns, by the way, who are getting cancer, which is why it was originally called the nun's disease, actually. Now, of course, people have tried to estimate how much bias there was from diagnosis, et cetera, but no matter how you cut the cookie, it looks like cancer rates have increased. And of course, part of the reason for that is unquestionably because people are living longer, especially compared to the Rigoni-Stern era, right? To Veroni's 1840s. And of course, cancer rates tend to rise as we get older. So you use age of diagnosis against cancer cases per year. And so it's a disease that primarily affects people of my age, right? And older. But I would also argue that cancer is partly what we call a mismatch disease. So mismatches are conditions that are more common or more severe because we are poorly or inadequately adapted to novel environmental conditions, right? And you know, obviously, tobacco is a novel environmental condition that we did not evolve to cope with, and it's of course the major cause of cancer and sunburns and eating too many hot dogs and whatever. But of course, that's not too controversial. But the other, of course, cause of cancer is energy, right? Because again, if you have excess energy, you can now plow it more into storage, into reproduction, and also become less physically inactive, right? And all three of these things are strongly associated as risk factors for cancer. And so if you look at cancer rates among, for example, individuals from high-income countries versus low-income countries, those cancers that tend to be energy-related are much, much higher, for example, in high-income countries versus low-income countries. So breast cancer, for example, or colorectal cancer, et cetera. So again, cancer is partly a disease of energy. And going back to that study I showed you earlier, that famous Aram et al. Study, they actually looked at cancer within that population. And I know one shouldn't really show big tables like this, but this is, again, cancer deaths. This is the hazard ratio for people who had low levels of physical activity, light levels of physical activity, and moderate levels of physical activity, divided by age groups, and you can see by physical activity levels, and you can see that the hazard ratio for cancer for moderate levels of physical activity, right, for when you're between 22 and 40 was 25% lower, in your 40s to 75s was 28% lower, and a good 31% lower for individuals individuals over the age of 75. And this is after, and if you're worried about covariates, you can spend a few minutes reading all the covariates that corrected for age, sex, smoking, educational level, alcohol use, post-high school training, college, marital status, history of cancer, history, et cetera, right? And this is a heavily controlled data set. So going back to breast cancer, if you look at meta-analyses from large studies, the average risk of reduction from 3 to 4 hours a week of moderate to vigorous physical activity decreases your risk, your lifetime risk of breast cancer, 30 to 40%, colon cancer between 40 to 50%. Here's another study just to kind of beat a dead horse a little bit deader. This is a prospective study from the American, Dallas, aerobic center longitudinal study, again, corrected for a wide range of variables, but individuals who had high fitness had more than a twofold reduction in breast cancer risk than individuals with low fitness. I could go on, right? And so final slide, why is that the case? Well, we could go into each cause later on, but again, there's sort of two pathways, and I think there's convincing evidence for both of them, right? So for one is that obesity and excess energy is a high risk factor for cancer. So physical activity lowers levels of inflammation, which can cause cancer. It lowers levels of insulin. Insulin is very tied to higher cancer rates. It lowers levels of estrogen and progesterone, as I showed you before. It lowers bloodstream levels of glucose, which are most cancer cells are sugar hungry. So that's one pathway. But then the other pathway is that physical activity increases the antioxidant production, which therefore helps prevent mutations. It increases anti-inflammatory myokines, which again help prevent cancer. It stimulates all kinds of enzymes that are involved in DNA repair. And finally, and maybe most interestingly, is that physical activity boosts the immune system from fighting cancer. So increases natural killer cells, increases cytotoxic T cells, and importantly also redistributes them around the body. So you have what's called a much more immunosurveillance for individuals who are physically active. For all these reasons, it makes sense why physical activity is a completely unbelievably undervalued tool for that we should be using to prevent cancer. So to conclude, exercise is weird. We evolved to be way more physically active than apes. We evolved to stay active as we age. And I believe that there's been selection for physical activity to promote health span, hence lifespan, through these various mechanisms. And these mechanisms help explain why lack of lifelong physical activity increases our vulnerability to a wide range of diseases that afflict our society now. One of them, just one of them, being cancer. And then my final point is that can we use an evolutionary perspective to help get people more physically active? And I think there's two points that we just need to keep in mind. The first is that when we tell people to exercise, it's usually a failure, right? People don't like, you actually give people pills. They don't even take pills. So why are they going to exercise, right? Because it's a counterinstinctive behavior. And when we medicalize it and commodify it, it's just not really working for the vast majority of Americans and people around the world. And then the second reason is that we evolved to be physically active for two reasons and two reasons only. It's necessary or rewarding. And if we want to help people be more physically active, i.e. exercise in our world, we have to find ways to make it more necessary and ways to make it more rewarding. And that's the only way we're going to actually make some progress. So I think I've gone on long enough, and I'm sure that there are some questions and I'd love to answer them. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm just curious, there's some people who are motivated to exercise and some people who are not. And is it possible that it's just your internal motivation to exercise is like the actual mechanism that keeps you healthy as opposed to people who...
Sure, that's part of it, absolutely. And there's been a lot of genetic studies of he's in Texas and having a senior moment who studies this.
The heritage study?
Yes. Yeah. What's his name again?
He just retired too. Patton also.
Yeah.
Down at Louisiana.
Anyway, Bouchard.
Right.
There are studies on it, but remember, these are all recent gene environment interactions. If you're a hunter-gatherer, you have no choice but to be physically active, right? And so only in the modern world that these genes start having some effect. And furthermore, what are we going to do about it, right? You're not going to be able to.
No, but it's just also there is this dilemma, which is some people really you know, are addicted to exercise. Some people are anti-addicted to exercise.
Right, but that can change because if you don't, for example, if you're unfit and addiction comes from dopamine, it's the reward mechanism. So people who are unfit, actually, and especially if they're obese and unfit, have insensitive dopamine receptors. So an overweight, unfit person who starts to exercise gets no reward from it. It's not pleasant for them. It takes months for that sensitivity to become so it takes a long time. So which is one of the reasons why it's hard to get people who are unfit to start to exercise, because they don't get their reward, but they do get it eventually. It's just hard, right? So that's, again, it's an environmental signal, but we do have a natural dopamine reward system for physical activity, which probably, again, is another, you can make sense. It's an evolutionary, you know, makes sense from a natural selection perspective. I don't know that there's any greater level of dopamine reward in humans than other animals. Mice too. I mean, if you have mice running on a wheel and they do it because they get a dopamine reward for it.
Well, and there's the famous study that David Reichlin did with the dogs and
the ferrets. Well, that was endocannabinoids.
Right.
So, we also get the runner's high, but you have to do a lot of physical activity to get a runner's high. So most people are never in that runner's high territory. But yeah. Yes.
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions, and you may have even answered them without me realizing it. The first is that you sort of zip through the role of increases in, upsetting medicine and health. But in particular, you didn't seem to mention even the huge increase in hygiene, that is,
oh, sure.
And so, which had presumably the greatest effect on
unquestionably
increasing. I mean, overall, much bigger than this.
Unquestionably, absolutely. So sanitation has had the most dramatic effect.
Yeah, that's been the biggest thing.
Absolutely, absolutely. But sure, there's no question. That's been the major cause for the increase in lifespan since the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution. But if you think about it, but sanitation has very little to do with chronic disease, right? Sanitation doesn't really affect how long you can live with diabetes. Sanitation doesn't really affect how long you can live with heart disease.
It does affect the spread of disease.
No, but I'm talking about health span, right? And so sanitation has effects on lifespan, average lifespan in the population.
But
right?
It probably does on health span, presumably, because it's keeping you, quote, clean.
Yeah, but the diseases you get from low sanitation tend to kill you quickly, right? Yeah. Cholera, et cetera. Nobody lives years with cholera, right? or smallpox or whatever. So the benefits of sanitation have been primarily on lifespan, but haven't had that much effect on how long people can live with chronic diseases.
I have a related question, I think, and that is that, for presumably most of the modern era, up until maybe the middle of the last century, most people, as you pointed out, really, I think, most people labored in one form or another. And yet the laboring class lived much shorter lives than the sedentary, richer people. I mean, given what you said, all that exercise would have sort of naively would have increased their lifespan. They may have lived shitty lives, but somehow, from the conceptual framework we presented, you might have expected to see an effect due to the fact that you're digging ditches all day.
So people who are digging ditches and or delivering our mail on foot or the bus conductors on the London bus, et cetera, right? I don't know if you know that famous study. They're much less vulnerable, again, to chronic non-infectious diseases, which is what, because we've gone through what's called the epidemiological transition. What you're doing is you're conflating, you're kind of adding the epidemiological. So, right. So if you were born in 1900, you'd die from influenza or smallpox or cholera, et cetera. Of course, COVID now is the number three cause of death in the United States. We have a little kind of a blip going on at the moment. But for the most part, we've had a switch from people being most likely to die from contagious diseases to people most likely dying and getting sick from non-infectious diseases. And so the physical activity that we're talking about is really relevant primarily to those non-infectious, non-contagious diseases. And that's the shift that we're seeing. So the very first study of this was done by Jeremy Morris in the 1950s. Classic study. And if any of you want to read a really charming pair of papers, it's his papers in 1953 in The Lancet, where he analyzed bus conductors and the London two-decker buses, and he compared the bus conductors with the drivers and showed that the bus conductors had half the rate of cardiovascular disease and half the half less likely to die than the drivers. And then somebody pointed out, well, you know, that might be biased because the drivers are also stressed because they're driving in London, right? So he compared postal workers who were delivering the mail with the bosses who were sitting in the office, and I can't remember where the office was, and showed he had the exact same effect. And of course, being a head honcho in the postal system was probably not super stressful, right? So that was like the first big epidemiological study showing that physical activity was really important for particular, in this case, heart disease and non-contagious disease. So it's really the epidemiological transition that's the kind of content there. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's a quick question. It really follows on with Jeffrey's, but early on in your talk, you were talking about differences in PAL for hunter-gatherers, and then with that Neolithic transition, we actually had an increase. But I was actually wondering if there was more variance, because you do have people who are specializing. You have people who are primarily potters and things like that. And
probably this is not, you know, we don't have a huge amount of data, especially from, there's no PAL data from the early, we only can measure physical activity levels on living populations, right?
Right.
But the subsistence farming populations that I work in, everybody's a farmer, right? Mm-hmm. People may do potting on the side. They may, you know, some collect firewood, make charcoal, et cetera, but everybody's farmer. So I think that most subsistence farming populations, with very few exceptions, everybody's a farmer, and then there's other specializations that are added on to farming. That's what I know about for most of the, but of course there's variance. There's variance in the hunter-gatherer populations too. I mean, you know, if you're a Northwest Coast Native American, you know, you have salmon swimming up your stream, you just don't have to work as hard as somebody who's living, say, in the Kalahari, I suspect. But I don't know if there's no data on physical activity levels from those populations. So of course there's variance, absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Related to this question about the farmers, so you said, yeah, the physical activity increased, but health spans notably decreased with these farmers. Is this also a result of the infectious disease thing?
Yes. So what happened with the earth, I mean, this is like not my research, but this has been a well-studied phenomenon, but once you get farming, you get people living in high population densities with their animals in permanent villages, surrounded by their feces and other people's feces and all the zoonoses they get from animals with, you know, easy, the perfect conditions for infectious diseases to get transmitted from person to person. So it's with the origins of farming, you get a massive increase in infectious contagious disease and a massive increase in diseases from poor sanitation, which is just not the issues that hunter-gatherers get. So hunter-gatherers, when they get sick from respiratory diseases or from diseases like malaria. That's, you know, all the major things that used to kill people until recently are mostly, many of them are products of origins of farming. And it's really not until sanitation that we begin to see a major decrease in most of those diseases. I'm just going around the room, so.
One sort of question that you partly answered was that if you had, with a lot more deaths from infectious diseases, once you eliminate those, how do you properly scale the arise and the incidence of things which are not infectious diseases? Because the one thing we know is that you don't live forever. So if you eliminate deaths due to infectious diseases, and we haven't eliminated them, but they've been greatly reduced over the past century, you still have to die of something.
Of course.
And so how do you properly measure the incidence of something like cancer or heart disease because you've eliminated other causes of death? So obviously,
well, incidence,
there's always something on the death certificate.
Of course, and you know, the number one cause on the death certificate today is heart disease. But if you go back to 1900, where we have data, heart disease was, I don't know, it's like the 10th most common cause. So the incidence of your vulnerability and the percentage of people dying from non-contagious diseases shot up, right? And it's not simply because, I think what you're trying to say is, since you have to die of something, that the reason we're dying of heart disease now is because we're not dying of influenza, right? Is that what you said?
At least that's part of it.
But we can study populations who are not Western, right? Who don't have live our lifestyles, we're physically active, aren't not eating, you know, crap diets full of, you know, processed food with all the fiber eliminated, and they're not getting heart disease. They're not getting, as far as we can tell, they're not getting cancers. They're not getting, diabetes is basically non-existent. So they're dying from, yes, you have to die of something, but they're dying of diseases that we actually are pretty good at preventing or staving off. So I'll give just one example. So that there's a population in the Amazon in Bolivia called the Chimane. They're forager fishers, and they have very physically active lifestyles, and they don't have access to market goods with added sugar and fiber and all those sorts of things. So there's a combination of diet and physical activity. This is the work by Hilly Kaplan and Mike Gervin. They've CT scanned over 1,000 of these individuals at all ages. There's no evidence for coronary heart disease at all. They don't get heart attacks. The number one cause of death in the United States, right? So we can definitively say that our lifestyle is increasing the incidence of these non-contagious diseases. It's not, and we can also study populations transition, which we're doing in Kenya, that's what we're doing in Mexico. We can study populations that are transitioning from rural lifestyles, you know, non-Western lifestyles to Western lifestyles, same population, we can see the increase in incidence of those diseases. They're clearly mismatched diseases caused by our environment. And one of those causes is unquestionably physical activity.
And one thing that's sort of a comment and a very simplistic view of something that's very complex is, especially this picture you have up or your comments before about why run, is to get from one place to another. And we do that now often with, say, fossil fuels, even over very short distances. And that there may be ways, and I mean, I remember reading some sort of silly things about obesity and the price of gasoline. There's a very good correlation around the world in the way you would expect that if it doesn't cost you much to get in a car, people tend to do that. And if it does, maybe you might do it by some other means.
So you're suggesting that one of the ways we can get people to be more physically active is to tax gasoline more, for example.
Or just to figure out ways to get essentially to get people out of.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I think it's really partly a political problem. It's partly a cultural problem. There's never gonna be one simple solution to this problem, right? It's gonna require many different ways of working on how to get people to be more physically active. But we have to understand that every time you're doing that, you're trying to get people to override a basic instinct. So one of my favorite sets of studies, they've been done all over the world, but you know when there's a stairway next to an escalator, you know, you've seen them in malls and airports and subway stops, et cetera. No matter where you are on the planet, right? The percentage of people who take the stairs willingly, and we're talking about like huge stairs, just a few flights of stairs, right? Is about 5%. Doesn't matter whether you're in Denmark or in Sweden or Israel or Japan or whatever. I bet if you did this in the Kalahari Desert, you'd get the same result, right? Because it's an instinct, even though there were no escalators in the study, it's just an instinct to save energy, right? And so if you want to get them stairs, yeah, turn the escalator off, right? Yeah. Towards makes people angry, right?
The virtual stairmaster.
So we have to find ways without being unduly coercive to help make physical activity more necessary, because it's an instinct to avoid. I mean, look, my office is in the fifth floor of the Peabody Museum, same building as Dan. And every day when I arrive, I have a little battle with myself because I want to take the elevator. Always, there's no question about it. And the reason I take the stairs 9 times out of 10 is not because I'm some, you know, special person who is like extra motivated to exercise and be super fit. It's because if anybody catches me in the elevator, I'll be a hypocrite. It's true. I mean, I'll get reamed, you know, and so I take the stairs, and it's a very good motivator for me.
Where's our parking lot, by the way?
We should just open the one all the way down.
Right down.
No. Even open for bicycles.
All kinds of ways to coerce each other, or if you want to be gentler, you can nudge each other. You've been waiting for a while.
So there are some studies that have shown that there's an effect of mindset on like weight loss, for example, and like hotel workers who, you know, like were told that, oh, you're actually getting more than the daily recommended blah, blah, blah of exercise. They started to lose weight compared to those who weren't told this. So I'm wondering if there's any similar studies for effect of mindset plus exercise on longevity or
I take that one?
Yeah, please. I mean, she reads.
Do you know Aaliyah Crumb at Stanford?
Oh, right.
Yeah, she's written the mind, and she did one really fascinating study. I'm sorry, Dan, do you want me to?
No, please,
she did a really fascinating study with women who clean hotels.
Oh, that's the
one. And who thought that they were not getting any exercise and were really upset about it. And then the researchers sat down with them and showed them that they followed them around to see how much they were actually moving. And then they sat down with them and showed them how much they were moving and that they were meeting the guidelines. Their VO2 maxes went up. They tested them before and after, and they went up because they realized that they were actually getting exercise. And then they also did become more active. It had a real impact on them because they didn't know that they were exercising.
Yeah, because,
and it did have an effect. So.
Is there anything on longevity or the ability?
She's probably doing stuff on longevity, but I haven't seen it published yet. So
okay.
But look, it doesn't matter because we know there's study after study after study after study after study shows a relationship between physical activity and longevity. Mm. But again, I would remind you that I think by studying making longevity our key output variable, we're missing actually the more important variable. Just not lifespan, I think it's health span. Mm-hmm. And the effects of physical activity on health span are much greater than the effects of physical activity on
health span. Is what I meant to say, not
And there's just no lack of studies on the effects of physical activity on an incredible range of diseases that are all related to health span.
And what about like mental health diseases? Is there just...
Oh, thank you for mentioning that. Yes.
I've been wondering.
I could give an entire lecture on that. In fact, I have one on my laptop. But in fact, we're doing a big study at Harvard now on just this topic. But okay. But physical activity is incredibly important for a number of mental health issues, especially depression.
Yeah.
And in fact, if you look at the randomized control gold standard studies, that are not just about prevention, but actually about treatment of people with clinically diagnosed depression, physical activity has as much, if not more, effect than any known pharmaceutical. And there's an interaction effect, by the way. And of course, if you think about it, most of the world doesn't have access to mental health care. It doesn't have access to SSRIs, et cetera. And it's a completely underused tool for treating depression, let alone preventing it. And it's also true for less so, the data for anxiety are not as strong, but all kinds of other mood related issues. And the mechanisms are not entirely a black box either. I mean, it has effects on serotonin, it has effects on dopamine, it has effects on norepinephrine, it has effects on GABA, so there's actually kind of mechanistic data that are also that help explain a phenomenon. For me, you have something powerful when you have both epidemiological data, you have mechanistic data, you have randomized control studies.
Yeah,
very solid ground there.
So is it just a political issue that seems like the psychiatric community hasn't really caught on? Like when I told my therapist I'm going on runs instead of taking medication, she was like, I really think that's a bad idea.
Yeah, I gave a lecture recently for the Grand Rounds for the Department of Psychiatry for Penn State, actually, just 2 weeks ago. We had a long discussion about this, but the vast majority of psychiatrists don't even ask their patients. They don't even ask if they're getting any exercise, let alone attempt to prescribe it. And look, sometimes it's because I think there's a sense, if you tell somebody to exercise, it actually can have it can have actually a negative effect, right? Because if they can't do it, it makes things worse. So that's one reason that people, that some professionals argue not to prescribe it, because it's hard to do, people don't like it, and then they end up not doing it, and so it could be counterproductive. But on the other hand, if you can help people do it effectively, it's also can be very effective. And so I'd like to see more of a debate going on in mental health about how and to what extent and in what ways exercise or physical activity, it doesn't have to be exercise, can be used in mental health. And we're doing this at Harvard now because, we have an epidemic like every other college campus of mental health issues. And we also know that the vast majority of our students, like most university students, are physically inactive. And so we're actually starting a study to try to actually look at how interventions will have effect, not only just on treatment, but also prevention. Because there's actually most of the data is on treatment. It's easier to do data on treatment than to do studies on prevention. Prevention studies are harder.
Yeah. We have time for one more question, and Jess has been very patient.
Okay, just
two related questions, building on my earlier question from your talk. So let's say we divide the world into people who have diseases marked by chronic inflammation and the rest, barring other illnesses. My first question is, that curve that you presented, is it possible that for the chronically inflamed, there's a slower build to the peak and then maybe even a longer decay? And then the second question, which is also related to that.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure which curve you're talking
about. So in the middle of your, it's the epic slide.
Oh, the epic slide, okay, yes.
And then in the second question is it possible that a distinction between people who have chronic inflammation and the rest of the, you know, normal healthy people is that the healthy people have what you might call a more canalized immune system. So it's less sensitive to inputs, environmental or physiological. And the chronically inflamed people, say with autoimmune diseases, are more sensitive to environmental variables and physiological ones like degree of exercise.
I have no evidence on that issue. I mean, certainly there's plenty of studies which show that people who are chronically inflamed get a huge benefit from physical activity in terms of reducing their inflammation through myokines. So let's just give you an example. So, muscle produces 100-fold, up to 100-fold more IL-6 than white blood cells can produce. And IL-6 is the major regulator of the inflammatory kinetic chain. And low levels are pro-inflammatory, but high levels are anti-inflammatory. And remember, IL-6, just like BDNF, IL-6, guess what IL-6 evolved for? For energy regulation. So muscle cells, when they run out of glycogen or whatever, that's what the muscle cell is sensing, turning on the IL-6, which then through TNF-alpha, et cetera, then regulate the inflammatory system. So overweight people, when they exercise or who are chronically inflamed, absolutely get the benefit.
Right, so I'm just frame shifting a little bit and asking whether in fact what's really going on here is that these people are more sensitive to the decrease in exercise that you talked about over the course of our sort of history. And consequently, we see revealed these autoimmune problems and chronic inflammation. So it's a question about the sort of size of the robustness of individuals to variation in inputs that affecting their immune behavior.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I'd be skeptical, but I don't know.
I don't know why you'd be skeptical. I think it sort of is an extension of what you're saying.
Yeah, but I just don't know. I don't have any information on that. So I just, it's an interesting idea.
So Dan's going to be around all afternoon. So please join me in thanking him. And then-